find it always welcoming to be introduced as a former corporate lawyer. I find that people tend to warm to me immediately, check that their wallets and other valuable possessions are safe and sound, and wonder how much they're about to be charged for the sermon. I was once asked at a speaking engagement with lawyers present in London to give my email address for any present who wanted to follow up afterwards with questions to be able to contact me directly. I received not one question, I'm sad to say. I did receive quite a few people's best attempts at their lawyer jokes. In case you know any lawyers, for what they're worth, here are the best three. What's black and brown and looks good on a lawyer? A Rottweiler. Second, what have you got if you've got 100 lawyers buried up to their necks in sand? Not enough sand. And my personal favourite was somebody had gone to enormous trouble to mock up a front page of the New York Times, announcing that they were about to start experimenting on lawyers rather than rats in the United States. They gave three reasons. There are more lawyers than rats in the US. There's less of a public outcry when they use lawyers rather than rats. And the third reason, well, at the end of the day, there are some things that rats just won't do. So if this former lawyer is going to preach to you, I take it we need God's help, so let's pray together. Our loving Heavenly Father, we've just heard Sharon sing beautifully of our hearts leaning on the living word of yours. And so we dare to pray this morning. We dare to come before you, knowing what we're really like in our heart of hearts, and yet knowing that you are a God of grace. And we pray that you might open your word to our hearts, and that you might, in your goodness and in your sovereign power, open our hearts to your word, so that we might be changed, so that we might be convinced of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and so that we might go out eager to live and speak for him. For we ask it through Christ our Lord. Amen. Gene Roddenberry was president of the Humanist Association of the United States. I don't know whether you knew that. He's probably much better known as the creator of Star Trek. Gene Roddenberry is the one who gave us Captain Kirk, Mr. Spock, Scotty, and Bones. And yet, when you watch the series knowing that he was the president of the Humanist Association, suddenly you see his humanism pervading the whole series. Indeed, the bridge of the USS Enterprise reflected Roddenberry's dream for humanity, a place where there would be no sexism, no racism, no nationalism. A bridge where the African female Lieutenant Uhuru could work together easily with the all-American male Captain James T. Kirk. A place where the Asian Sulu could work together harmoniously with the Aberdonian Scotty or the Vulcan Spock. And yet what was so tragic about Roddenberry's dream was that he had to set it so far in the future, some 250 years from today. And in interviews and in print, he freely admitted that he never imagined his dream would become a reality, not for hundreds and hundreds of years. Well, despite Roddenberry's desire for us to boldly go where no man had gone before, it's just a shame that Roddenberry himself never went back to the Book of Acts. Because if he'd studied Acts chapter 16, he would have discovered that the agency capable of bringing diverse people together into genuine unity, gospel unity, wholehearted unity, was none other than the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. As Liam was reading it, you'll have noticed Acts 16 presents the gospel advancing into Europe for the very first time. And yet I guess if we'd been there, we might not have imagined what we were witnessing was really as significant as it's turned out to be. It's often the way, isn't it, in world history, that turning points at the time never seem to be quite as significant as they are in hindsight. Who would have imagined, for example, that when the Archduke Franz Ferdinand was assassinated in June 1914, who would have imagined that it would have unleashed World War I, leave millions dead and a continent changed forever? Or who would have imagined that when Alexander Fleming returned from his summer holiday to his lab at St. Mary's Paddington, just up the road from Christchurch, Kensington, who would have imagined that he would discover some mould growing on petri dishes, go on to discover penicillin, and make a lasting impact on the health of the world? Or perhaps more recently, who would have imagined that in 2013, when the UK's Prime Minister, David Cameron, said he would hold a referendum about Britain's relationship with the European Union, who would have imagined that it would lead to Brexit and unleash the political consequences that we've witnessed in the last month in the United Kingdom? And who would have imagined that the events described in Acts chapter 16 would have such a global impact, or would be such a turning point in the world's history? Did you think that as Liam was reading it, as we heard of the first Christian converts in Europe? Did you think that these events would go on to have such massive implications? If the gospel had not reached Europe, Christchurch Kensington might not exist. The UK's history would be radically different. The UK and Europe's history has been profoundly shaped by the Christian gospel. It shaped our values, our music, our architecture. Our whole cultures have been impacted. And it began with these apparently insignificant events we've just heard read. The world's history would also, I take it, be radically different, because you'll be aware that it was from the UK in the 17th century that the gospel came to these shores. It was from the UK and from the Americas in the 19th century that the gospel spread to the four corners of the globe. And yet today, 2,000 years after the events described in Acts chapter 16, you'll be aware that there have been decades of decline in the continent of Europe. Chapter 16 takes place in the nation of Greece, where today, although some 95% of the population would claim to have a Christian connection, 95% seems pretty good, doesn't it? But only 2% of them are in church on any given Sunday. There is a tremendous need for Europe, facing as it is rampant individualism, dehumanizing materialism, and increasingly militant Islam. There is a tremendous need for Europe to hear the gospel of Christ again. It came as a real shock to me to discover a few years ago that Australia were training men and women to go and serve as missionaries in France. These men and women hardly knew any French. As far as I could work out, they just about mastered English. apologies if you're an Aussie. And yet these men and women, these brothers and sisters, were willing to travel halfway around the world to take the gospel of the Lord Jesus to the people of France. How embarrassing for the people of the United Kingdom on France's doorstep. How shaming that it would be left to the Aussies when we were so close. How much easier for a church like Christchurch Kensington, surrounded as we are with 500,000 French people living in West London. West London, I don't know whether you knew this, is the sixth biggest French city on the planet. We have 500,000 French people living around us who fled Monsieur Hollande's tax policies and come to live and study and work in London. Well, if we're going to play our part in the great mission of the Lord Jesus in West London, if you're going to play your part in that mission here in Philadelphia, well, there are big lessons all of us can learn from Acts chapter 16. In it, we see the Apostle Paul encountering three very different individuals. Lydia, a businesswoman from Thyatira in Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey. a slave girl and this Philippian jailer. Luke's been very selective in giving us details of these individuals who are the founding members of the Philippian church. Usually he's much more generic in the book of Acts. You'll be aware that often he just says many Jewish people, many Gentiles, many Greeks were converted to Christ. But here, as it were in Acts 16, the camera zooms in and pauses to give us three case studies, three individuals, three cameos, if you like, of the early church. Why does he do that? Well, I take it so that we would learn three vital lessons. Here's the first one. The gospel of God is advanced through opposition. The gospel of God is advanced through opposition. It's hard to imagine two more different people than Lydia and this slave girl in Acts 16. Lydia, high-status businesswoman. She's a seller of purple goods. That was the luxury brand of the day. Think Armani, think Gucci. That's the kind of thing she's doing. And this slave girl, no status, no wealth, no belief in the God of the scriptures whatsoever. And yet Luke tells us in verse 16 that she has a spirit that enables her to tell the future. In other words, she has a python, literally a python spirit. Pythons were said to help the devotees of Apollo to tell the future, to discern what was going on in the world. This girl is clearly someone in the grip of evil. There was satanic opposition. And so just like the Lord Jesus, when he encountered that demoniac in the gospel, you'll recall, the apostle's heart obviously went out to this slave girl. She is clearly disturbed, if not deranged, crying out constantly day after day. And although she brings her owners much gain, all she seems to get is much grief. Her future looks far from bright. This poor slave girl is stalking the Apostle Paul and his team, crying out. Did you notice verse 17? These men are servants of the Most High God, who proclaim to you the way of salvation. I take it we can see immediately why they wouldn't be too keen on having her endorsement. I've been here for the last 2 weeks and I've witnessed both the RNC in Cleveland, Ohio, and I've witnessed the DNC here in your beloved city of Philadelphia. Hours of my life I'm not going to get back. There is a phrase in England called Hobson's choice, which means you're between a rock and a hard place. And I would have thought your election this year is exactly that. You can choose the Donald or you can choose the Hillary. And all the people said, Lord, have mercy. Can I say, if they were desperate for Ted Cruz and Bernie Sanders' endorsement, the Apostle Paul was not eager in any way for this a slave girl's endorsement. He would have undoubtedly have feared that her crazed ravings would have put off the more sensible people. But was that the only reason that he acted so decisively? Because his own sensibilities were at stake. Now, I take it that Paul knew that there was a very real possibility that people might confuse her message with his gospel. You see, the ancient Greeks referred to Zeus, the god of Zeus, as the Most High God. They used the phrase salvation to refer to being saved from the powers that control our fate in the world. So there's the Apostle Paul and his team preaching the momentous news about Christ. They would have said, God came into the world in the man Jesus. He was the only Lord. Only his death could save you from your sins. And yet she is following them round, essentially saying, that's much the same as what the Greeks are saying. See, Paul knew there was a very real possibility, not only of satanic opposition, but of religious confusion. And Paul doesn't want anyone listening to confuse her crazed ravings with the gospel message. And that's why he acts so decisively, notice in verse 18. Paul having become greatly annoyed. The word in the original could mean annoyed or irritated. I guess we'd understand why he would be annoyed, but it could also mean grieved. Paul having become greatly grieved at her plight, at her predicament, turned and said to the Spirit, "I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And notice at that very moment, because Paul has spoken with Christ's name and therefore with Christ's authority, immediately the evil spirit leaves the girl. Friends, it was a great miracle. The gospel of God is advanced despite opposition. And my guess is we would expect such a wonderful transformation to lead to great rejoicing. But please notice Paul's miracle, just like Christ's in the gospel, led to another form of opposition. It led, notice, to spurious allegations. Verse 19, the slave girl's owners, her pimps, if you like, are furious. They've exploited her talents for telling for fortune telling, to make a fortune for themselves. And this girl's miraculous deliverance is a financial disaster for them. So they seize Paul, they seize Silas, and notice the very clever way in which they make their case against them. Glance down to verse 20, would you? And when they brought them out to the magistrates, they said, "These men, Paul and Silas, are Jews, and they're just disturbing our city. They're advocating customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to accept or practice." See, they're not very honest about their motives, are they? Rather than admit that their concern is financial, the owners get the crowd on their side. How? By appealing to civic or racial pride, by pandering to a latent popular anti-Semitism. And you'll know that those kind of tactics have been used down the centuries. But in this case, here in Philippi, neither of the accusations was right, was it? They were Jews, but they weren't promoting Judaism. And they certainly weren't advocating anything illegal for Roman citizens. They weren't a threat to the state. They weren't a threat to social cohesion and harmony. Now, as Rodney Stark and others have demonstrated, wherever the gospel advances, whichever nation it reaches, it blesses. It is good news for that nation. Now, the reality here in Acts chapter 16 is that the owners stirred up opposition through their spurious allegations because of the damage that it was doing to their commercial and financial vested interests. One commentator describes the tactic as labeling. We've seen that, haven't we, in recent years? How often are Bible-believing Christians labeled as outdated and narrow? Effective labels, but just labels. How often are those who are committed to a biblical line on Christian marriage caricatured as bigoted or homophobic? Labels. What's the outcome on this occasion for the Apostle Paul? Verse 22, the mob are mobilized, and then the authorities decide to act. The magistrates, notice, appear keener to keep the peace than they do to know the truth. And so they side with the crowd. And please notice there was real pain and suffering for Paul and Silas. They're falsely accused, they're beaten and they're locked up, not just in any prison. Verse 24 tells us it was in the inner prison, the maximum security unit, if you like, where their feet were fastened in stocks. And we're not to think of those medieval stocks that, school summer fairs, you probably don't do that in this country, you're probably much more civilized than us. In the UK, in school summer fairs, they stick the teacher's hands and head through medieval stocks and the kids line up to and pay their money and throw wet sponges at their teachers. You're probably far more civilized than that. Notice here, they're not those kind of stocks. They're the sort of stocks that would have stretched Paul and Silas's legs so far apart that they were clearly a means of torture. There was a physical pain for Paul and Silas. I take it there was also emotional pain. These cultured, educated men are now jailbirds. And I take it there was genuine spiritual pain also. How easy for them to cry out, "Lord, what are you doing? Why have you brought us all the way from a successful first missionary journey in Asia Minor? Why have you brought us to the continent of Europe for this? What on earth is going on?" And yet, if you've read the book of Acts before, you'll know that this is something we see happening all the way through the book of Acts. Keep a finger in Acts 16 and just flip back to the very beginning of the book, as Liam said earlier, to Luke's second volume. Acts chapter 1, glance down to verse 8. If you want a summary verse of the entire book of Acts, this is it. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. The risen Lord Jesus, just before he ascends to his Father's right hand, says to his followers, "You will be my witnesses." Where? In Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. That is the summary of the book of Acts. The gospel will advance, the risen Lord Jesus says, in Jerusalem, throughout all Judea and Samaria, and then to the ends of the earth. And yet, cheek by jowl with every stage of the gospel's advance, goes gospel opposition. Sometimes it was from within the church, as some sought to deceive it. Often it was from outside the church, as some sought to destroy it. You'll have noticed it was often strikingly from the most religious people, as they sought to crush Christianity in its infancy. And yet here in Acts chapter 16, we see it's also from vested commercial interests. I don't know about you, what I find so striking in Acts 16, in verse 25, it is what Paul and Silas are doing once they're imprisoned. They don't know what's going to happen next, do they? But they're trusting God and they're rejoicing. They're praying and they're singing hymns. Things don't look good for them, but they know that God is in control. And so even incarceration cannot stop the advance of the gospel. Suddenly, verse 26, a great earthquake shakes the foundations of the prison. All the doors are flung open and the chains are loosened. Do you see, because the Christian gospel is God's gospel, nothing can thwart it. He is absolutely sovereign. He is the king. No obstacle is too great for God. It's been a constant theme in the book of Acts. And it gives us two key truths for us to reflect on this morning, this week, and this year. Truths that all of us need to take to heart. Here's the first truth it gives us. The gospel will be opposed. I hope you know that. 23 out of 28 chapters of the book of Acts show us people suffering for the gospel of Christ. Opposition to the gospel doesn't just come from the Jewish religious leaders, it comes from Gentiles too. So please don't be surprised. Please don't be surprised when you see opposition to the gospel in your workplace, in your neighborhood, in your school, in your college, here in Philadelphia or around the world. Don't be surprised. But don't be shaken. Don't be shaken by it. Because the second great truth is that God is in control. God uses persecution in the book of Acts. Do you remember? He used the persecution in Jerusalem in Acts 6 and 7 to drive the Christians out. Where? Into all Judea and Samaria, the very next stage of the gospel mission. Philip and co. took the gospel and they told others about Christ. Here in Acts 16, we see Paul and Silas imprisoned, but it's not the end of the gospel. because we see a jailer hear the gospel and become a Christian. And when at the end of this chapter, Paul and Silas are asked to leave Philippi, notice that they make sure they're publicly vindicated first. I take it they don't do that just because they're overly sensitive or proud or defensive. I take it they want a public vindication of the gospel for the sake of the church they leave behind in Philippi, to show to everyone that it's not anti-state, it's not threatening to social cohesion and harmony. But they insist upon that vindication, and then they leave. And what do? They go on to Thessalonica, and they go on to Berea, and they don't stop preaching Christ. The gospel of God is advanced not just despite opposition. The gospel of God is advanced through opposition. Here's the second vital lesson to learn today. The gospel of grace is available for all people. The jailer wakes up to the earthquake. He sees the prison doors are open. He assumes the worst. The prisoners have all escaped. He knows it's his neck on the block. He'll be executed, and so he prepares to kill himself. But verse 28, the Apostle Paul cries out, "Don't harm yourself, for we're all still here." The jailer can hardly believe it. He fetches the lights, he rushes in to check, and when he sees they're still there, he falls down before Paul and Silas, trembling with fear, and he asks that wonderful question in verse 30. "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" I guess God may have been at work in his life for a while. He may have heard that slave girl wandering around Philippi, crying out, "These are the men who can tell you how to be saved." And when he heard her say that, he may even have asked himself, "I wonder what it would mean for me to be saved." Then as he imprisoned Paul, he'd no doubt have been struck at how Paul was at peace. And I'm absolutely certain Paul and Silas would have spoken to him of Christ, of how God came to earth in the Lord Jesus, of how in love Jesus went to the cross, so that we might all be free. And when the jailer sees that Paul and Silas don't do a runner, when he sees the integrity of their life backing up their gospel message, he knows the gospel must be true. And so he wants to become a Christian. And Luke focuses on these three different people to show us that the gospel of grace that is right at the heart of Christianity is for all kinds of people. You see, after the gospel advanced from Jerusalem into Judea and Samaria, it met two obstacles that could have caused the church to stumble in its very early days. The first obstacle was that Jewish Christians didn't think they needed to share the gospel with their Gentile neighbors. Now, that would limit the gospel, wouldn't it? If it was only ever going to be something for Jewish people. And so we saw the Lord Jesus in Acts 9, do you remember, appoint Saul of Tarsus to be an apostle for the Gentiles. And then we saw the Lord Jesus persuade the apostle Peter that he could eat with Gentiles. And if he could eat with Gentiles, then he could share the gospel with Gentiles. And so in Acts chapter 11, we witness Cornelius, that Gentile, become a Christian. We saw that Jewish Christians could and therefore should share the gospel with their Gentile neighbors. And so it was no surprise that in Acts chapter 12, 13, and 14, that's the very thing we see happening. Gentiles are hearing the gospel from Jewish Christians. But the second obstacle was just as serious. You see, some Jewish Christians tried to suggest that if Gentiles became Christians, they also needed to become Jewish too. They needed to adhere to the Old Testament law. And so in Acts chapter 15, we saw Paul expose that kind of thinking and teaching as a different gospel to the gospel of grace, which says that ultimately we're not saved by what we do, but by what God has done for us in Christ's death and resurrection. And so the Jerusalem Council in Acts 15, they agreed that Jewish Christians could and should share the gospel with their Gentile neighbors. And if that wasn't radical enough, they agreed that if Gentiles became Christians, they didn't need to become Jewish too. You see, those two obstacles that could have prevented the gospel advancing in its very early days, those two obstacles were smashed. And now the gospel of grace was free from any Jewish constraints that might have hemmed in the advance of the gospel. And it's no surprise that in the very next chapter of the book of Acts, Luke introduces us to these three people: a woman, a slave, and a Gentile, representatives of the three groups to whom any Jewish man would have found it hardest to take the gospel. Indeed, did you know a Jewish man would wake up every morning and give thanks to God that he wasn't a woman, a slave, or a Gentile? But what the council agreed theologically in Acts chapter 15, that the gospel of grace was free for all types of people, Luke is now showing us practically with these three case studies in chapter 16. Luke is making an absolutely foundational point. He's saying that if these three people could become Christians, a woman, a slave, and a Gentile, if they can become Christians, then anyone could become a Christian. I hope you believe that. And it's that truth we see playing out in this chapter, where we see a Christian community established, a community that's made up of people of different genders, of different races, of different religious and social backgrounds. Do you see, instead of fast-forwarding 250 years, Gene Roddenberry would have been much better advised to rewind the clock 2,000 years. Back in the early 90s in the UK, Liam will remember that we had a Prime Minister called John Major. John Major was a good man, I think. And yet John Major had a vision, he said, of a classless society, that he wanted Britain to become a classless society. Somebody should have pointed out to John Major that he was 2,000 years too late, because Luke tells us it's already been achieved. That is just how radical the Christian gospel is here. It smashes every kind of barrier that we might want to erect to divide people. So I hope you don't think that church or Christianity is just for certain types of people. The Roman jailer, he would have been a blue-collar worker, wouldn't he? The Roman jailer was hardly a religious type, hardly a church-going type. It was hard to imagine three more different people than this businesswoman, this slave girl, and this jailer. I hope we don't think that people have to become like us if they become a Christian. It's all so easy for churches to make that kind of mistake. My guess is in 2016, we're unlikely to recreate the Jewish constraints today. But we don't need the Jewish constraints, because we've got enough of our own in the 21st century. How often do we give the impression to people outside that Christianity is limited to people like us, who come from our sort of background, who wear our sort of clothes, who adhere to our sort of political or ethical outlook on life? And when somebody walks in the door and comes to church who isn't quite like us, we can feel uncomfortable, can't we? Anxious in case they join us in our pew, not quite sure what to say to them over coffee before or after church. But Acts chapter 16 reminds us that the gospel of grace is available for all kinds of people. Can I be a rude foreigner and make an observation? It has saddened me in the 2 weeks that I've been here that I've observed that there is still in this country a racial divide. In our country, Liam will know, there's a class divide. That's our hang-up. We've never got over it. There is still a serious class divide. I don't think there's a racial divide to the same extent as there still is here. And that is why it is wonderful to hear Christian leaders and to see churches like 10th that are models of the truth that we are all one in Christ Jesus. Three vital lessons to learn. The gospel of God is advanced through opposition. The gospel of grace is available for all people. And finally, notice the gospel of Christ is accepted through belief. You see, the scriptures are clear. The gospel is available for all kinds of people. But it's also clear that we need to do something to respond to the gospel, to make it our own, if you like. The jailer knew that, didn't he? Remember his question, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" I wonder what you would say to that question. There's no more important question to ask, is there? I do hope you're not labouring under the false assumption that the most important question at the moment is who will win in November. That is not the most important question. Certainly not who will win the Super Bowl or the Premier League or something like that. The most important question anybody can ever ask is this one. What must I do to be saved? Because there are only two kinds of people. Saved and lost. Did you know that when the Titanic left Southampton on that fateful maiden voyage, it left Southampton with five classes of passengers, from first class all the way down to steerage, which would have felt like storage. First class all the way down to steerage. Five classes of passengers, five kinds of dining room, five areas of decks you were allowed to use, five kinds of cabins, five kinds of beds, five kinds of pillows, five classes of passengers. And then it struck the iceberg. Then it had its calamity. And when the wires and the telexes came through to New York, there were only two classes of passengers. Those who were saved and those who were lost. Friends, please believe me when I say there is no more important question anybody can ever ask than what must I do to be saved? And Paul's answer, what must the jailer do? What must we all do? It's there in verse 31, isn't it? It's very simple in one regard. It is to believe in the Lord Jesus. It's such a strikingly simple message. Notice the apostle doesn't say that the jailer needs to go to church for many months or years. He doesn't say that the jailer has to go and sort out his life and become a much better person. It's not ultimately about what we do. We need to believe in the Lord Jesus. But what does that phrase mean? See, as I've traveled around the United States over the years, as I've traveled around the United Kingdom, I've noticed that lots of people believe in Jesus in the same sense in which they believe in George Washington or Winston Churchill. They agree that he lived. They intellectually assent to his existence. But it makes not a jot of difference to their lives. The Greek verb that's translated here, believe, means to depend on, to rely upon, to lean your whole weight on. So, friends, at the moment, you're all exercising faith. You're all depending upon the pews on which you're sitting to bear your weight. They look pretty robust pews to me, so you're probably pretty safe. But you're exercising faith at this very moment. You are leaning your whole weight on those pews. That's what it means to become a Christian. To stop having one hand on Christ and the rest of my body over here in my career. To stop having one foot on Christ and the rest of my body over here leaning on my family or on my peer approval or on my grades or whatever it is. I must stop doing that. I must turn from doing that, and I must lean my whole weight on Christ. Have you done that? We must be saved, and only the Lord Jesus can save us from our sins. One of the things that surprised me most about going to seminary was meeting Margaret at a local church placement. Margaret was 73 years old, and Margaret told me she'd been attending that church every Sunday of her life since she was born 73 years before, around the corner. Isn't that marvellous? 73 years, every Sunday at the same church. That wasn't what surprised me. What surprised me was that when Margaret told me that until 2 years before, when the new pastor was appointed, nobody had ever told Margaret how to become a Christian. Isn't that staggering? 73 years, faithfully attending church, and not the first clue how to become a Christian. Friends, can I say, if there's anybody in that position this morning, you will not find a clearer description in the whole of Scripture than verses 30 and 31. They tell you how to become a Christian. It really is very simple. We receive the good news about Christ not by being good, not by being religious, but by depending on Jesus to save us. We are the drowning man who grabs the winch, the rope, dangled down to us from the helicopter. We need to be saved, and only Christ can save us. It's never that hard to tell if somebody's become a Christian, because almost invariably their life is totally transformed. And we see that here with the jailer, don't we? Verse 33, what does he do? And he took them, Paul and Silas, that same hour of the night, and he washes their wounds, he puts right what was wrong, and he's baptized at once, he and all his family. He shares the good news of Christ with his family and they're baptized. You see, another life transformed, just like that slave girl. Another open heart leading to another open home, just like with the businesswoman Lydia. I love the fact, I've loved hearing from Liam how you've got opportunities in your parishes to take things further, to ask questions, to do a course like Christianity Explored. I highly commend that course to you. It's a brilliant course. Hundreds of people have come to Christ in London by doing that course and hearing the gospel and having a chance to ask their questions. If you're here today and you wouldn't call yourself a Christian, let me urge you and encourage you to sign up for something like Christianity Explored. And if you're somebody who, just because you've heard Liam preach for however many Sundays it was, 80-odd Sundays through the book of Isaiah, and you've stumbled into the Christian faith, you've turned and trusted in Christ for yourself, ask him afterwards, ask one of the elders, how you might take the opportunity to profess that faith publicly. That's what the jailer does here, doesn't he? He professes his faith. But as we consider how the gospel reached Europe for the first time, I hope you found Acts 16 to be very challenging. Friends, the gospel is for all kinds of people. Christ is for people of different genders, people who are different socially, different religiously, different racially. Christ is for all. He's for you and he's for me. He's for different ages and stages, different colors, different creeds. He is for all the people outside, as well as all the people inside, if they will but turn and trust in him. Jean Roddenberry was 2,000 years too late. The agency that brings different people together is none other than the gospel of grace through the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you believe that? It was great hearing about this analysis of your mission, this review of how you might more effectively serve at the city of Philadelphia, how you might take the gospel to the people of Philadelphia. Well, I hope that this will be right at the heart of it, that you believe that the gospel is for all kinds of people, from other races, from all religions and none, and from all socio-economic groups. I hope you found Acts 16 to be challenging. But I hope we've also found it to be wonderfully comforting too. The Lord is absolutely sovereign in advancing his gospel of grace. No obstacle will prevent the gospel reaching to the ends of the earth. I have stood on Cape Point in South Africa. I have stood with my back to the continent of Africa, with only the penguins of Antarctica in front of me. And I have said to my children who are here this morning, I have said, look, behold, the gospel has reached the ends of the earth. It really has, friends. because nothing can stop it. And you don't need to wait 250 years until the USS Enterprise comes along to see all sorts of, frankly, very odd people working together. Because don't take this as a means of offence, but you ought to be able to look round every Sunday morning and see the gospel achieving just that. I pray that it would be true for you, as I hope you'll pray it would be true for us in West London. Let's pray together. Our loving Heavenly Father, we want to praise and thank you this morning for the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, for that momentous news. We want to thank you that it is good news of salvation for all kinds of people. Please forgive us for those barriers that we put up, that the gospel tears down. Help us to be a community here at 10th that genuinely welcomes all kinds of people, that encourages all kinds of people, that shares the gospel of Christ clearly, faithfully, compellingly with all kinds of people. Help us to trust in Christ for ourselves today, and help us to continue to trust in Christ despite and through opposition this week and this year. For we ask it in the precious and powerful name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.